people have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course, we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show. It's been over 100 days since Taliban swept to power in Afghanistan and the human rights situation in the country is in doldrums. The new forms of epidemics they are facing are unprecedented unemployment and acute poverty. And despite repeated warnings from international organizations of financial collapse in the country, they have got little to nothing in response. Observers say if the world continues to watch everything like it has done so far, then the country is certainly heading towards a human catastrophe.
Kabul residents say their 100 days after the Taliban takeover have been extremely difficult, with concerns growing over the security and education of girls. They say the Taliban, which had made promises of altering their position with regards to women, have not shown any change since sweeping to power in August. Apart from the unemployment rate that has spiked suddenly, there are expanding shortages of food and money. With US freezing the Afghan money, the situation has only worsened. The United Nations has repeatedly warned since the Taliban took over that Afghanistan's economy is on the brink of a collapse that would likely fuel a refugee crisis, but little have been achieved in that direction. Red Cross has expressed its disappointment over sanctions and donor freezes, which it says are cutting off basic services in Afghanistan, and they called on donors to find creative ways to prevent a massive humanitarian crisis. Afghans say they have no clue as to what their future would be like if the current situation persists for longer time. They say nothing could be predicted under Taliban control.
از نگاه روحی بسیاری مردم تحت فشار قرار دارن. چرا که خیلی ها نگران آینده خودشان است، نمیفهمن که خب در آینده چی چیز پیش خواهد آمد. با گفته بعضی ها که افغانستان حالا جای شده که عجایب، یعنی یه چیز قابل پیش بینی نیست.
One of the Taliban's first acts since taking over the country on 15th August 2021 was to reassure Afghans of their safety. The Taliban announced a general amnesty and said no revenge would be taken in the group's first press conference on 17th August. This was significant given the terror wrought by the Taliban in the past 20 years of conflict and the deeply ingrained memories of the Taliban's first period of rule from 1996 to 2001. However, none of those promises were kept. Reprisal attacks, sanctions on women, hardline Sharia law, and anything even remotely against the Taliban are met with brutality. Since 15th August, the crisis in Afghanistan has been the focus of many international fora, including UN Security Council meetings, the UN Human Rights Council's 31st special session and 48th regular session, and G7 and G20 meetings.
How
However, the international community has thus far failed to chart an adequate path for the protection of rights and to hold perpetrators of human rights violations accountable.
Sri Lankan courts have started the trial proceedings in Easter Sunday bombings that had killed nearly 270 people in 2019. The police have filed over 23,000 cases against the suspects that include conspiring to murder, aiding and abetting the attacks, and collecting arms and ammunition. However, the defense has argued that these cases are not going to bring real justice and the procedure will only be dragged by a decade.
A Sri Lankan court has begun the trial of 25 men accused of plotting the Easter Sunday bombings that killed nearly 270 people in 2019, as lawyers warned of a long and complicated legal battle ahead. The suspects were brought under heavy guard in batches from different prisons by police to the Colombo High Court during the morning hours. The group includes Mohammed Nawfal, who the officials say masterminded the attack and is linked to the Islamic State. He was escorted by armed police to the court with his face covered by a piece of cloth.
At 25 suspects have been indicted, and this is the second time this case is coming up today. I'm appearing for about six accused. And in my opinion, it's a futile exercise. It's not going to bring any results.
Another key suspect is Y.M. Ibrahim, the father of two of the suicide bombers, Inshaf and Ilham Ibrahim, who targeted two hotels in Colombo. The police have filed over 23,000 charges against the suspects, including conspiring to murder, aiding and abetting the attacks, and collecting arms and ammunition. Lawyers representing the suspects said the charges were too many in number and the case could take as much as a decade to conclude.
Uh, 23,000 charges have been framed against all the 25 suspects. It is very unusual, and perhaps it is historical insofar as the history of Sri Lanka is concerned. I think it's a real conspiracy, carefully planned, to drag this case for about another 10 years, because it's not possible to conclude evidence to prove 23,000 charges.
The string of attacks carried out on April 21, 2019, Easter Sunday, targeted three churches and three hotels, killing 267 people, including at least 45 foreign nationals. At least 40 children also died. The attacks that have been called the worst in Sri Lanka's turbulent history also injured about 500 people, mostly belonging to the island's minority Catholic community. Saint Sebastian Church in Negombo and Saint Anthony's Shrine in Colombo were two of the churches targeted, while the Cinnamon Grand Hotel and the Shangri-La Hotel were also badly hit in the attacks.
Moving on. The government of Nepal has kicked off vaccine drive for teenagers in Nepal and is inoculating them with the Pfizer-BioNTech doses it received from the United States last month. The decision was taken in the wake of massive resurgence of mutated coronavirus in European and American countries. The country will receive more doses from India in coming days. However, the concerning news from the Himalayan nation is that it is not keeping proper track of those who have been vaccinated, which has resulted in several of them not receiving their second jab.
Teenagers aged between 12 and 18 stood in line to get jabbed as the government of Nepal kicked off a vaccination drive with the US-donated Pfizer vaccine for teenagers. Hundreds of students studying in secondary and higher secondary levels of schools stood under the basking sun, waiting for their turn to be inoculated. Nepal is one among the few countries that are inoculating their citizens below 18. However, a lot of others, including its neighbor India, have come up with a plan to jab the rest of them in near future. While a small section of the society is still reluctant, the government of Nepal has by and large been able to come over vaccine hesitancy. Students say they were scared with the kind of resurgence and mutation the virus has displayed over time, and they are happy to have been jabbed.
First, I am very scared about COVID-19, but now I am feeling secure.
Kathmandu has received over 100,000 doses under the COVAX program and will receive several thousand doses from its neighbor and ally, India, in immediate future. A shipment that was to leave on 22nd November from India's Serum Institute of India was halted after the Nepalese side asked for a halt owing to some preparation issues and will likely land Kathmandu in a few days. Guardians, however, are happy with the fact that their children too will have immunity against the virus that has mutated several times since its outbreak in China in late 2019.
हजुर त्यो त अब सुरुमा त अब आफूलाई भ्याक्सिन लगाउने भन्दा पनि अब यो खालको बच्चाहरूलाई चाँडै लगाइदिन पाए हुन्थ्यो जस्तो चाहिँ नि अब लागेको थियो किनभने अब उनीहरूले अब आफ्नो प्रब्लमहरू बताउन सक्दैन होइन केही गरी भइ पनि हाल्यो भने पनि अनि त्यही भएर फर्स्टमा अब हामीलाई भन्दा पनि उनीहरूको लागि जरुरी थियो त अब तर अब ढिलै भए पनि अब लगाउन पाइयो अहिलेसम्म अब हामीले सेफली नै राख्यौँ उसलाई स्कुलहरू पनि अब खुल्ला भए पनि पठाएनौँ होइन अब जेस ढिलो भए नि लाउन पाउँदा चाहिँ नि धेरै खुसी लागेको छ।
The bigger concern for Nepal, however, is that a large number of Nepali residents who took the first dose of either AstraZeneca or Verocell vaccine have not taken the second dose within the prescribed gap. Reports say 10,000 to 15,000 people have still not sought second doses, and even more alarming is the fact that the Ministry of Health and Population does not know the whereabouts of the people who took the first dose of vaccine and have missed second. The Health Ministry does not have a database to track the people who are not seeking the second dose. Critics call it a failure when they say an ideal model of India was lying right in front of them, which has digitally maintained data of every single individual who has been vaccinated. Meanwhile, India's Bharat Biotech, which has developed WHO-approved Covaxin, is reportedly set to roll out its vaccines for teenagers. Despite being the second most populated country, India has partially vaccinated nearly 80% of its citizens and is resuming its vaccine Maitri program aimed at sending vaccines to its allies and those who are still deprived of it.
And now in our section of Asia this week, the stories from across the continent that hit the headlines this week.
Thousands of university students have taken to the streets of Sulaymaniyah in Iraq's semi-autonomous Kurdistan region, protesting against Grand Kurds. Security forces used tear gas and water cannons to disperse protesters. On Monday alone last week, 18 people were injured during the protests, including both security forces and protesters. Students are protesting for the reintroduction of a monthly payment of at least 50,000 Iraqi dinars, which is about $34, as well as lack of services in university dormitories. The grants had been cut since 2014 when Iraq's Kurdistan region witnessed an economic slowdown as the Islamic State took over swathes of Iraqi territory. Israel kicked off a nationwide campaign to vaccinate children aged 5 to 11 last Tuesday, hoping to beat down a recent rise in coronavirus infections. A fourth wave of infections that hit Israel in June began subsiding in September. But over the past 2 weeks, the R or reproduction rate of the virus that had remained below 1 for 2 months
began climbing and has now crossed the threshold, indicating the virus could again be spreading exponentially. Daily cases have also crept up over the past few days, with half the confirmed infections presently among children aged 11 and younger. Israel's 9.4 million population is relatively young, with around 1.2 million children in the 5 to 11 age group. By November, that group comprised more than a third of new cases, according to Health Ministry data. Policymakers also say that the vaccination of younger children is meant first and foremost to protect their individual health and not just to stop the transmission of the virus. A poll by Israeli healthcare provider Maccabi found that 41% of parents to children aged 5 to 11 were positive they will vaccinate their children, while 21% were still undecided and 38% will not vaccinate their children. Tokyo is a densely populated city. It has unique flood control facilities that help prevent rainwater disasters. To prevent flooding during the rainy season, there is a huge underground water storage facility in the city. Wada Yayoi Trunk Sewer is one of the largest rainwater storage lines in Japan. It is a huge storage facility with an inner diameter of 8.5 meters, a length of 2.2 kilometers, and a storage capacity of 150,000 tons. To prevent noise from falling energy, the system also uses a drop shaft that rotates and drops water to the bottom so that it does not damage the facility's power. This is a model of Wada Yayoi Trunk Sewer. In times of heavy rainfall, the river rises and flows into sewers to prevent flooding. On Wada Yayoi Trunk Sewer, water is poured into the reservoir to prevent disaster. The drop shaft method allows water to move smoothly. Tokyo's sewage system is prepared in a way that prevents all kinds of rainwater disasters and guarantees life safety to the citizens. Located in Gifu Prefecture, Hida Takayama is a traditional wooden shopping street that dates back to the Edo era. It is designated as a Japanese traditional building preservation area. Many tourists visit here to enjoy the beautiful landscape. A souvenir shop, Hida Komachi, in the area sells a special ice cream. The shop's original product is jam and sauce, which are prepared from local ingredients. Another popular sweet is ice cream, which is prepared with cow milk and peach. Hida Komachi soft ice cream is filled with flavors of chestnut cookies. Tourists enjoy the rich and refreshing taste of this ice cream. The delicious soft ice cream developed by Hida Komachi and Nisei is a popular delicacy among tourists.
Colorful celebrations, tasty treats, great hospitality and communal peace mark the celebration of Jammu and Kashmir festivals, which successfully portray the diversity of Indian cultures. The beautiful valleys of Kashmir, the shrines of Jammu and the peaceful monasteries of Ladakh put together a series of festivals throughout the year. One among these is Ladakh's Thikse Gustor festival, which was recently celebrated with great zeal and enthusiasm.
With the rhythmic beats of religious musical instruments and monks roped up in traditional costumes, India's Northern Union Territory of Ladakh recently hosted the two-day Thikse Gustor festival. Gustor means sacrificing, while Thikse is the monastery where this festival takes place. Hundreds of spectators, including local residents and tourists, conversed at the monastery to get themselves immersed into the festive spirit. Celebrated on the 18th and 19th of the 9th Tibetan calendar, the highlight of this festival is the colorful charm dance performed by the monks of the monastery, who wear masks representing protectors, gods and goddesses. The custom is believed to ward off any evil spirit from the village. Tourists who were present at the festival expressed elation at colorful traditions of Ladakh.
ये मोनास्टिक में ये फंक्शन बहुत अच्छा है, वो पूरा यहाँ पूरा टेम्पल्स अच्छा है, पूरा बुद्ध भगवान का संस्कृति बहुत अच्छा है। लडाख वेरी नाइस प्लेस, इधर अच्छा क्लाइमेट अच्छा है, तो क्या बोलते हैं यहाँ आदमी अच्छा है, यहाँ दुकान वेरी नाइस अच्छा आदमी है, बिल्कुल यहाँ आदमी ईमानदारी आदमी, वेरी नाइस लडाख।
The protective faces of the deities, which otherwise remain covered for the rest of the year, are open for public only during this festival. The early morning prayers are conducted every day, and at the conclusion of the event, a special ceremony called Agram is performed. The entire process of Agram portrays the symbolic assassination of traitor King Langdharma of Tibet by Buddhist monk during mid-9th century. The effigy of Langdharma is made, and through elaborate rituals, all the negative spirits are transferred into it by a sacrificial substitute, after which the effigy is burnt ritually.
यहाँ हमारे जगत की जितने भी हमारे प्रॉब्लम में या दुख की समुद्र में हम लोग डूबा हुआ है, तो इसका मेन कारण मेन मकसद यह है कि हमारा जो सेल्फ ग्रेसिंग और सेल्फ चेरिशिंग की वजह से होता है। तो जो सेल्फ ग्रेसिंग और सेल्फ चेरिशिंग यानी आत्मा धरान होते हैं, वो पूरा एक क्या कहते हैं लिंगा के रूप में यहाँ आग में डाला हुआ करते हैं। तो इसका मकसद यह है कि जितने भी हमारा प्रॉब्लम्स का रूप जो है हमारा सेल्फ ग्रेसिंग और सेल्फ चेरिशिंग होते हैं, इसकी वजह से हमारे नाना प्रकार का दुख हुआ करते हैं। तो इसके लिए इसकी वजह से भिक्षु मंग्स यहाँ पूजा भी किया करते हैं, साथ ही साथ एक लिंगा के रूप में एक रूप में पूरा जो हमारे दुखों है जो उसका दुख का कारण है वो पूरा आग में डाला दिया जाता है। इसका मकसद यही है।
The beautiful monastery of Ladakh becomes a perfect tourist destination, especially during this annual festival of Thiksi Gusto, which is celebrated with great faith and devotion by the people of the region to live a meritorious life. The festival represents the rich culture and traditional heritage of Ladakh and gives a great experience of pure country life away from the hustle and bustle of the city.
Along with Thiksi, the festival also takes place in monasteries of Spituk and Karsha Nanskar, and it concludes with the distribution of a sacrificial cake known as Torma. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.
Subscribe TAG TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.